Good morning. My name is James Baroud, and it is my pleasure to welcome you this morning, and specifically for accommodating our new parking situations on this unseasonably warm morning. Many of you may have been up late last night, like myself, and no matter who you supported, I'm sure you'll join me in congratulating our new president-elect, Barack Obama, and I know we all hope that in Washington and in the rest of this great country that we can come together and collaborate and support innovation going forward. This is what this country was built on, and this is what will make our country strong in the years to come. Now, as many of you know, innovation and entrepreneurship has been the hallmark of our program that's almost 20 years old now. You know that we continue to lead the region and indeed the nation in programs just like these that help you manage, lead, and sustain innovation at your workplace. So with that brief introduction to this great event, it is my pleasure to introduce Dean William Moore, who has been a great supporter of ours, the Dean of the Silverman College of Business, Dean William Moore.
Good morning. It's my pleasure to also welcome you to Fairleigh Dickinson University. I got back in town late last night, and I thought I would go to bed because I thought about, I think it was King George II who said on, who wrote his diary on July 4th, 1776, nothing of importance happened today. So I decided to stay up a little while. And glad. We're pleased to have you here. And for those who had parking difficulties, I want to apologize for the parking inconvenience that some of you may have experienced. The fire warden has said to us we have to reconfigure our parking pattern on campus, so we're trying to get that straightened out for now. Innovation, creativity, entrepreneurship, those words are etched in our minds and our hearts, especially those of us in business, because those things really carry the country now. So I'm pleased that we are continuing with the CEO Innovation Lecture Series. So important, seeing so many of you here is heartening for us because our programs depend on your support. And our programs are aimed at helping you as well and helping this community, helping this region to grow and prosper. And the more that we can innovate, create, bring about something new and different, the better we're going to be. As most of you know, our Rothman Institute has for a long period of time been recognized as a leading organization for creativity, innovation type series, sponsorships, workshops, you name it. We have a lot going on at Rothman Institute, and to see that it has been not only nationally, but internationally recognized as a thought leader, as a provider, is something that in the Silverman College of Business we're very proud of. So I want to commend Jim Baroud for all that he's done well, that he continues to do. And thank you. Without your support, we cannot continue to do what we do. So we're very appreciative of your being here this morning, and hopefully you will continue to come back for more that we have to offer here at Fairleigh Dickinson University. But you're not here to hear me talk. You're here to hear others who have been doing a lot in this area. So it's my pleasure to introduce a person who has been a leader in New Jersey in the effort aimed at innovation and creativity and entrepreneurship. She's been very influential in just the short period of time that she's been in her office. In early 2006, Governor John Corzine named Angie McGuire Deputy Chief of the Governor's Office of Economic Growth. She is responsible for coordinating the state's economic development efforts, and has been charged with developing and implementing a strategic business plan for the state of New Jersey. Angie has more than 20 years' experience in telecom and community industries, most recently as the president of Enterprise Communication Systems at Lucent Technologies. She has been a principal at JMA Associates for the past 3 years, a firm providing management and marketing expertise. Angie served on the board of directors of the Volunteer Consulting Group, Home Wireless Networks, the Research Institute for Small and Emerging Business, and the Center for Telecommunications Management. So it is my pleasure to bring to the podium Angie McGuire. Angie.
Thank you, Dean Moore and Jim, for hosting us today. It's a pleasure to be here with you. As everyone's already commented, it was a long and exciting night last night for many of us. And regardless of how you voted, I'm sure that you'll agree that the incredible turnout of the American voters last night, I think it was somewhere around 62-64%, was a real stroke of strength for democracy, and it was just a very exciting night. But what doesn't change, even with the results of the election last night, is the state of our national economy and the impact in New Jersey from the financial crisis that's upon us. New Jerseyans are very worried, jobs have been lost, and Governor Corzine has called for some action. So I thought today I'd just make a brief set of comments about the action plan that Governor Corzine's introduced, and then talk about the role we see of the energy industry very briefly, which I know Ralph is going to spend his time on. Economists have predicted that New Jersey would lose, or will lose, tens of thousands of jobs as a result of the Wall Street fallout. Our casino revenues are in decline, and thousands of construction and manufacturing jobs have already been lost. Auto and retail sales are down, and inventories are climbing. In response, late middle of last month, the governor proposed a comprehensive recovery plan for the state. And while our response will not insulate us from the interconnected world in which we live, it can cushion us in the recession and position New Jersey for a strong recovery. The proposed plan addresses four broad areas. The first is it provides immediate assistance to those with the greatest needs, both in terms of support for high energy costs and mortgage support. Secondly, it directly supports short-term employment and economic activity by providing incentives to companies that have already chosen New Jersey as their home and providing both tax credits and cash payments to those who create jobs in New Jersey during these difficult times. Third, it works to enhance New Jersey's business climate and long-term economic prospects. The governor has announced support for a number of tax changes, long-term tax reforms, including the extension of net operating losses to be taken over 20 years instead of the current 7, to eliminate the regular place of business requirement, and a number of other steps. He's also directed the taxation and treasury departments to start reviewing the single sales factor apportionment factor for New Jersey, which businesses have been telling us for a number of times prevents them from growing in New Jersey. So a number of tax changes we'll be working with business on so that we're, again, well prepared for the recovery that will eventually come. And fourth, and importantly, his plan addresses our obligation to remain fiscally responsible even during a time of declining revenues. And you know, this administration has been marked by a focus on always matching expenses to ongoing revenues. That has not traditionally been the approach of government in New Jersey, and it's a very difficult thing to do when revenues are in decline as they are. So we know we'll be looking to everyone in the state as we take the inevitable pain that comes with those kinds of budget cuts. There's a full presentation of his plan on the state's website if you're interested in looking at it. But I really thought that I'd focus today on the element of the governor's recovery plan that looks toward job creation in the future. And we see tremendous opportunity in the energy sector. The governor released his energy master plan last month. and it includes policy actions that will literally create tens of thousands of jobs over the next 10 years. Particularly important for the near-term job growth, we're taking policy actions that promote residential energy efficiency and carbon abatement investments, actions that produce hundreds, if not thousands, of green-collar jobs and the private sector jobs. PSE&G, New Jersey Natural Gas, and Atlantic City Electric, as well as many small business subcontractors, are ready to begin work as soon as it's authorized through the Board of Public Utilities. This win-win initiative can happen immediately, and jobs can be created without investing state dollars. And over time, the state will lower its carbon footprint and consumer energy bills go down. Similarly, we're working with the state legislature on a package to promote energy efficiency in our schools and public buildings through conservation equipment and weatherization to prevent excessive energy use. Private contractors provide the capital, they grow their workforce, and they're repaid through recaptured energy savings. We're looking to collaborate again in these public-private sector ways where private innovation, private capital can serve the public good and create both new jobs and opportunities. We're encouraging this private sector investment in energy efficiency with legislation that would allow $80 million of private sector investment in state facilities and local facilities. In an effort to stimulate the economy by lowering consumer energy bills and stimulating job creation, Governor Corzine is moving aggressively to put in place $500 million worth of energy efficiency programs. This means an investment total of approximately $1 billion in clean energy programs for residential and business customers and the creation of 3,000 jobs over the next year. We're promoting clean energy through manufacturing funding. We're providing a new grant program and a low-cost loan program for companies that elect to do their manufacturing for clean energy technologies in the state. And through the Edison Renewable Energy Technologies Fund, we're providing funding for the New Jersey technology companies that do proof of concept, research and development, and activities like that to commercialize identifiable renewable energy technologies. The Commission on Science and Technology, and I see one of my fellow commissioners here today, I serve on that commission as well, will be awarding grants to New Jersey companies in the amounts of $100,000 to $500,000 for work in research and development in these innovative technologies. And companies can also receive, if they're successful with that development, another 20% beyond that grant in the form of low-cost loans to commercialize the activity. The governor's also announced recently that we have a plan to triple the state's offshore wind goal to 1,000 megawatts by the end of 2012, and we've awarded the first contract to do that off the coast of Atlantic City. New Jersey's energy future is being built from a strong starting point. We have one of the strongest solar programs in the country, potentially the country's first offshore wind project in the works. Our participation in the regional greenhouse gas initiative is the most aggressive greenhouse gas emission reduction target in the nation. Innovation in New Jersey is really going to drive our energy future. The work of companies like PSE&G is important for the collaboration we need. Ralph Izzo has been a recognized leader in driving innovation and service orientation at his firm and in New Jersey, and he and the governor have both underscored the need for leadership in addressing the energy challenges we face, including ensuring the reliability of our energy supply, controlling energy prices in the face of unprecedented cost increases, and mitigating the state's contributions to global climate change. If global climate change continues unabated, sea levels are likely to rise significantly, with possible catastrophic effects to coastal states like New Jersey. Ultimately, without innovation and action, the Garden State economy will continue to depend on an unsustainable and outdated energy system. So by embracing these new approaches to energy, we're providing the pathway to economic prosperity and environmental protection. Our goal is to create new jobs in New Jersey, to improve the business climate, to encourage innovation and growth, and we welcome the feedback that you have for the state. Please feel free to send us email or grab me afterwards if you have ideas on how we can improve that. And I'm really looking forward to Ralph's lecture this morning. Thank you.
also my pleasure to introduce another influential leader and friend of Fairleigh Dickinson University. For more than three decades, Fred Hassan has been an influential force in the pharmaceutical industry. He's especially well known for transforming corporate enterprises, building a sense of teamwork and cooperation, and fueling tremendous growth. As the CEO and chairman of Pharmacia Corporation, Fred was named CEO of the Year in the global pharmaceutical industry in 1999. In 2003, he joined Sherry Plough as CEO and chairman and helped engineer a fundamental transformation that has garnered acclaim, generated significant growth, and innovatively responded to society's great needs. I should also note that Sherry Plough is the sponsor of today's event. 2 years ago, Fred was the first CEO innovation lecturer. Thanks, Fred. He helped kick off this wonderful series in an impressive fashion with some interesting stories and enlightening lessons. Today, he will help us once again by introducing our speaker for the morning, Fred.
Morning. And thank you, Dean Moore. Thank you, Angie. Today is a very important day to talk about innovation. Our nation's economy is at the crossroads. The global economy is at the crossroads. And as we look forward to the future, we have to rely upon innovation to make a decisive difference in the way the world is going to evolve. We've seen from the past that innovation brings about growth, prosperity, and jobs. We also see that innovation creates opportunities for the young people of the future, and that's why I'm especially pleased to see so many young people in the back who are students who are also hoping to be a part of the innovation society that we are all going to be evolving to a much bigger extent than ever before. I'd like to just say that in the first lecture I said that innovation is not just creativity, it's really taking the creativity and putting it into something that's of some use to people. It's the whole process. So it's not just basic science, it's a lot more than that. And it really takes a lot of work, and it takes a lot of patience, a lot of passion, a lot of courage, and a lot of tenacity. The president-elect, President Obama, has made innovation a critical priority for our nation. He has a tough challenge as he takes on this very, very difficult job. And we know that all of us are going to work hard to make innovation occur, because that's been so important to the U.S. prosperity and progress in the past. Now I'd like to say a few words about my friend Ralph Izzo, the German president, CEO of the PSENG group. PSENG is one of the top 10 utilities in the U.S. It was founded in 2003. Ralph, who is a PhD in applied physics, joined PSENG in 1992. He has played very important roles in operations, in finance, and in policy. He is a true innovator. The energy industry, as you heard from Angie, is critical to the future of our nation and to this state. There are great opportunities. Ralph has already done great things with solar panels, and I know that Ralph will be doing a lot of other great things as we go forward into the future. And at this point, with great pleasure, I'd like to introduce Ralph.
Thank you. It's truly a pleasure to be with you today to deliver your 2008 Innovation Lecture.
I know that's a somewhat obligatory comment on the part of speakers when they're invited to a function, but let me just explain to you why I say that with genuine sincerity, notwithstanding the collective sigh of relief that we all feel to have another election behind us. If I were to nonetheless poll this audience and ask you to name the five most innovative industries or the five most innovative companies that come to mind, I have no doubt that there'd be a fair representation of shearing plows in that list, and pharmaceutical industries, that we'd throw in a few Googles and maybe an Apple here and there. But I would be neither surprised nor disappointed if the utility industry and PSE&G did not show up on the list. And I think that that's probably consistent with the hallmark and the tradition of our industry and our company, that being to be as invisible and as reliable as possible. That when you wake up in the morning and throw that switch, you don't throw that switch and say, thank goodness PSE&G was there for me, or isn't that a wonderful feeling that I'm using electricity? And I will tell you, even I don't say that when I wake up in the morning. But if you throw that switch and it's not there, you do have a few words to say about PSE&G, perhaps next to. And in light of that, therefore, you don't think of utilities as being on the cutting or leading edge, because sometimes being on the cutting or leading edge leads to being on the bleeding edge and is not consistent with reliability. Having said that, I do think that my communications people warned me that this thing would not just go from slide to slide, and as an innovator, I had to be flexible and nimble and learn how to deal with that. Having said that, I think that there is a history in our industry of innovation. Perhaps the greatest inventor of all time, Thomas Edison, was the founder of our industry. And here we actually are showing him visiting one of our power plants, the Kearney power plant, over a century ago, as Fred mentioned. And those innovations did not begin and end at the turn of the 20th century, turn of the 19th century. They continue today. In fact, PSEG was one of the first companies to band together with other companies in the New Jersey, Maryland, Pennsylvania area to form a regional transmission system. We have innovated by creating a business process using helicopters to literally service 500,000 volt transmission lines while they are alive, while the power is flowing through them. It's a simple application of Faraday's law. I will tell you, I pride myself with spending a lot of time with our employees and visiting with them and doing the work that they do. I drew the line here. I was not, as a matter of fact, I would not even let them take the helicopter up without the doors on it. I said, the doors go on or I stay on the ground. But nonetheless, this was featured recently on a one-hour National Geographic program. You may have seen it. I forget the title of it. It's Miserable Jobs or Amazing Jobs or something like that. And my wife dutifully told them, we can't possibly pay these people enough. And I said, don't you dare say that in front of any of them. But having that history of innovation leads to a company that we are today, and an industry that we are today, and an industry that really prides itself on two words, operational excellence. They are the foundation of our financial strength. That financial strength is the foundation of our ability to invest in new and innovative areas that Angie touched upon, and I'll spend the rest of the presentation speaking about, through use of tried and true technology, but innovative processes. We've managed to position ourselves as in the top 10% of our industry in terms of employee safety. It is literally safer for most people to be at work at PSE&G than it is for them to be walking around their house. Whether they are standing in front of a gas pipe or a high voltage transformer or in a nuclear plant, they are literally statistically safer at work. We were recently named for the third out of fourth year the most reliable electric utility in the nation. We've won that award 7 years running in the Mid-Atlantic region. We're one of, I believe, only three companies in the nation that have paid dividends for each of the past 100 plus years. And for the last 5 years in a row, we've raised that dividend to our shareholders. So operational excellence, financial strength provides us with the ability to make some exciting investments going forward. And what might those investments be, and how innovative might they be? I'd like to talk about our number one challenge in our industry and something that will truly test our creativity, not only as an industry, but as a society. While we were all thinking about and paying attention to the meltdown on Wall Street the past few months, there was a bigger meltdown that was taking place in the Arctic sheets over the summer. In fact, ice the size of the state of Alaska, and I don't know how many New Jerseys you can fit into that, but quite a few was taking place. Something that scientists, while they will not use the word irreversible, do say is very difficult to reverse. And I believe it's about 1,600 scientists who participated on the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change who have said that this is real and it is caused by human activity. The sources of the greenhouse gases that are driving climate change are shown here in this pie chart. I want to step away from the numbers for a second and try to impress upon you the impact, the societal impact of what we're dealing with here. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change said that by 2050, we need to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by approximately 80% from where they are in 2005. And the president-elect has embraced that target. And we will be one of several companies and hopefully one of many constituents who will be down in Washington on January 21st to remind them of that commitment. Suppose for a moment that every one of us was not allowed to use a vehicle that was in any way, shape, or form propelled by fossil fuels. That not only means that you have to trade in your eight-seater SUV that gets 12 miles to the gallon, that also means that you cannot use a Prius, that you cannot use a plug-in hybrid, that if you're fortunate enough to buy a $100,000 Tesla that gets 200 miles to the gallon, you couldn't use that either. No vehicle that uses any form of fossil fuel in any way or shape, whether it's 10 miles to the gallon or 100 miles to the gallon. So you can get around on a form of transportation that does not rely upon fossil fuels. That could be an electric train. It could be a scooter. It could be a bicycle. It could be walking. That is the only form of transportation you're allowed. I don't care how big the airplane is. It uses petroleum. You can't use it. Second assumption, any device that relies upon electricity is banned. Not only the obnoxiously loud boombox coming from the neighbor next door, but the incubator that's operating in a whole host of hospitals right now keeping premature babies alive. And in fact, that $100,000 investment you made in that electric vehicle is now unplugged. If you allow me to make those two ridiculous, if not absolutely absurd assumptions, and try to fathom for a moment what that does to society and lifestyles as we know it, we don't meet the 80% reduction target. We don't meet the 80% reduction target. The pie chart clearly shows that 28% of greenhouse gas emissions come from transportation and 32% come from electricity. By higher sophisticated calculus, you add those two numbers and you come up with 60%. So, is the lecture over? No, not at all. Fortunately, we have until 2050, and therein lies the role for innovation and creativity. We are faced with nothing less than the complete electrification of transportation, the complete and total electrification of transportation, and the complete and total decarbonization of electricity. And that will bring us short. But those are the only two things that I have a role to talk about today, so I'll trust Fred and his colleagues to worry on the industrial and the commercial and the other aspects of it. Let's continue. Let's talk a little bit about electricity. In the electric sector, we put out about 2,500 megatons, 2.5 gigatons of carbon per year as of 2005. Business as usual would increase that about 25% by the year 2030. There are a myriad of options that are espoused by the Electric Power Research Institute, which I will refer to henceforth as EPRI, to help bring that number down. But you can see here that even EPRI thinks that technology as it is currently envisioned, can reduce greenhouse gas emissions from electricity by about 25% from their 2005 levels by 2030. So we need some radical change and some radical differences in the way in which technology is evolving to make this completely carbon-free. The pie chart here, the prism chart as we refer to, has a host of options ranging from energy efficiency to renewables to nuclear power to the continued reliance on fossil fuels for generating power, but the capture and storage of the CO2 emissions that come from that. PHEV is plug-in hybrid electric vehicles, DE is distributed electric generation, and CCS is carbon capture and storage. Another look at the same project, at the same set of options was put forth by McKinsey and Associates. I'm sure most of you are familiar, global reputation as being a very thoughtful management consultant organization. And what McKinsey has done here is said that if we can take the amount of carbon that we reduce down by one-third, okay, so remember I just showed you a chart that said electricity was about 3 gigatons. Electricity is a third of the total, so that means the total is about 9 gigatons. You see here a 3-gigaton reduction along the x-axis. Then we have a whole host of things that we can do. And these are forecasted costs to undertake these actions in the year 2030. Okay, so we're projecting technology forward today to the year 2030. On the left side of this chart, you see things that fall in the category of shame on us for not doing them immediately. These are things that actually save people money and are plotted as negative cost per ton of carbon to reduce. And it's a bit of an eye test, but I hope you'll believe me when I say that most of these largely fall into the category of energy efficiency. There are things that we can and should be doing today to reduce our consumption of energy that will actually save us money and therefore reduce emissions into the atmosphere. As you begin to move to the right, you start getting into slightly less economically compelling energy efficiency technologies, but more so energy production technologies that will cost more to implement. And these run the gamut from nuclear to solar to onshore and offshore wind, as well as some carbon capture and storage of fossil fuels. I'm not going to read all of them. The point of this is that there's a lot of stuff that we can begin doing today that makes enormous and economic sense. There is some stuff that we will have to do tomorrow and pay to do that. We will have to increase energy costs to do so and therefore derive enormous benefits, in the raising of those prices, not only in terms of mitigating climate change, but in terms of just in general having healthier and cleaner air to breathe as we emit less SO2, NOx, and fine particulate matter and mercury. But there will be an investment that will be needed. So let me talk now a bit about how PSEG is approaching this myriad of options. First and foremost, I hinted at it a bit already, is energy efficiency. We're doing things to help ourselves and we're doing things to help our customers. What are we doing to help ourselves? We are changing the lighting in our buildings. It is literally as simple as that. We're moving from incandescent technology to compact fluorescent technology. We're changing the drivetrains in our fleet. We're moving from diesel power to hybrid vehicles. We are changing our heating, ventilating, and air conditioning systems in our businesses. We are taking those that are old and less efficient and replacing them with those with newer and more efficient. And how are we helping customers? We're trying to educate. We're literally giving out, or I guess we finished giving out, over 100,000 compact fluorescent light bulbs and also reminding customers that due to the trace amount of mercury in those, that we don't want to play the good old-fashioned New Jersey shore game of whack-a-mole and solve one problem and have another one come up. And these need to be properly disposed of. And many home improvement centers have recycling locations where you can dispose of compact fluorescents that do contain trace amounts of mercury. We're working with municipalities to change their street lights, not to fluorescents, but to light-emitting diode technologies, which actually are leapfrogging fluorescents in terms of their energy-saving capability. And as Angie alluded to, we are begging the Board of Public Utilities for permission to enter into customers' homes and be indifferent as to whether or not we invest a dollar in a transformer or a dollar into a home energy-saving device so that we can help our customers reduce their consumption of electricity. And I'll spend a little bit more time on that in a few minutes. The challenge with energy efficiency is, why isn't the left side of this chart happening? Why is it when a homeowner goes into their favorite home improvement store and sees this funny looking squiggly bulb on the left hand side that costs $3, and they see a normal shaped, for lack of a better word, incandescent bulb right next to it for $1, and they read the packaging, and the packaging clearly states that the funny squiggly shaped one will save them $30 in energy cost and replacement bulbs, and is far and away better than any investment they could make, whether it's risk-free on in treasury bills or value investing in this current day and age? Why is it they reach for the $1 incandescent bulb? It's very simple. In economic theory, that individual is applying a discount factor to the squiggly bulb that says, I don't believe the packaging. I don't know enough about this technology. I am not sure that I will achieve the savings that are promised there. Therefore, I am applying a much higher expectation. I don't want to make my money back in 1 or 2 years. I want to make it back in 1 or 2 months. I want the return on that investment to be 50%, 60%, 40%. And then a very smart, a very wise 15% return doesn't get implemented. This is not just true of homeowners, it's true of businesses. I've spoken to many of our largest customers. I've had some tell me that they will not make an investment in energy efficiency unless it pays itself back in 3 months. I know of very few investments that pay themselves back in 3 months. And the reason is not irrational. In competition for capital, and it has never, ever been more acute than it is today, if I have an extra dollar to spend, I am not going to necessarily spend it as a business on a non-core investment such as improving my lighting, even if it is going to pay itself back in several years. I'm going to invest that in marketing, in R&D, in sales, in my core business. So energy efficiency, while technologically here in a large degree, more needs to be done, suffers from an imperfection in the market in that the people who need to invest in energy efficiency, i.e. the customer, is not looking at energy efficiency with a hurdle rate that will allow the left side of this chart to go forward. Second phase of PSEG's efforts are in the renewables areas. Here we did get approval from the Board of Public Utilities to launch a $100 million loan program that is actually now 50% applied for in just 6 months. The applications for this have greatly slowed down. I would say it was 40% applied for in the first month. It then slowed down because there was uncertainty over federal tax provisions and how renewable energy would benefit from various investment tax credits and production tax credits that were available to the renewable industry sector. That was finally resolved a month or so ago. That created quite a dampening effect, however, while people were unsure if they would get these necessary tax benefits. We have not seen this pick up, even though the tax benefits have been extended. I can only assume it is because that while this is a loan, it is a loan for half of the construction cost, and access to capital has been shut down. So the other half of the construction cost is very difficult for people to come up with the money for this. We're still optimistic. We're still encouraging people. It still is a very, very attractive deal when you include the subsidy inherent in our loan, the energy savings associated with putting the renewables on one's roof, and the tax benefits that are offered by the federal government. However, it is something that we're keeping a careful eye on. Angie did mention that New Jersey has named a winner in a solicitation for offshore wind. I am surprised that she did not mention that the winner of that solicitation was a joint venture that includes PSEG. It's a 350 megawatt joint venture. It's about $1 billion in investment. We are at the point now where we are talking to the federal agencies that are relevant here, the Mining and Mineral Service Agency, MMS as it is called, about what are the conditions under which we can put our meteorological towers up in this site 16 to 20 miles offshore to collect wind data. That will be a one to one and a half year effort of data gathering before we would go ahead and actually design the project. So we're genuinely excited about moving forward. Offshore wind probably is New Jersey's best resource from the point of view of renewable resources, best from the point of view of concentration of the resource. We are blessed with many things, but onshore wind and solar in abundance are not two of them. Lastly, PSEG has recently acquired the rights to a technology that's been in existence for over 16 years and functioning in the state of Alabama, known as compressed air energy storage. The challenge with renewable energy is you have to collect it when it decides to be available. That may or may not be coincidental with when our customers decide that they need it. It is a good news story in solar. Solar tends to be most available during hot, sunny days, which is when air conditioning load goes up. So there's a fairly good coincidence there. Believe it or not, the wind tends to blow mostly in what we call the shoulder seasons, spring and fall, and it tends to blow mostly at night. Those are literally the low points in demand in our system. So the ability to take wind and store it, albeit overnight into the next day, is critically important for making optimal use of wind energy, and that's what compressed air allows you to do. You capture the wind energy at night. You use that to compress air in some underground cavern. And then in the daytime, you allow that air to expand and drive a turbine and produce electricity. We are looking for sites not only in New Jersey in the area of compressed air energy storage, but also in New York and in Texas where we have other facilities. And lastly, PSEG does have a small biomass facility up in New Hampshire that we would look to build upon in the New England area. The last of the three ways in which we would seek to decarbonize electricity beyond renewables, beyond energy efficiency and renewables, is what we call clean central station power. Growing in people's willingness to consider, although far from, I think, widely socially accepted, is nuclear power. Here we have fallen into the same trap as others. We are showing you a cooling tower, which is as much to do with nuclear power as it has to do with coal power, but the nuclear power plants we're showing here are our three units down in Salem County at a site that was always designed for four units. Any efforts to develop nuclear power are at least a decade away, and therefore emphasis must be given to the first two that I talked about a minute ago, i.e. efficiency and renewables. Now, building a green future is not just about having the technology available. Angie alluded to some of this in her remarks. I alluded to some of this in my energy efficiency remarks a moment ago. There needs to be a business and policy framework that makes this, that makes all of those investments more real and more doable. I'm going to start on the left side of this slide and talk about price signals. Right now, we are freely polluting. There's just simply no other way to describe it. I am a firm believer in markets. I know that as an audience that is as sophisticated and as entrepreneurial as this, I suspect that there's a bias towards markets in this room as well. Markets are incredibly efficient over certain time frames. Some would argue that they are very efficient over the shortest of time frames and fairly efficient over medium time frames. But there's a well-known theory that sometimes markets do not capture externalities. It is hard for me to believe that markets today are accurately pricing the effects of changing Atlantic City from a 100-year floodplain to a 10-year floodplain. And forgive me, but there is no one in this room that can convince me that markets today are accurately pricing what it will mean in terms of social and political dislocations to the people of Indonesia if we see sea level rise on the order of tens of meters by the year 2050. Having said that, to a great extent, we are buying and consuming energy on the backs of our children and our grandchildren. In fact, the scientists I've spoken to said we've already ruined our children's future. Right now, we need to do things for our grandchildren's future. And it has to do with the inertia inherent in the global climate system. Number one action is for Congress to implement legislation that shows the same kind of leadership and courage that our own Governor Corzine did in joining the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative and passing the Global Warming Response Act for the state of New Jersey. Congress needs to enact legislation that sets limits on CO2 emissions and raises the price of electricity in doing so. That is really tough for someone to do, but nothing less can be accepted. The numbers I showed you before for the marginal cost of reducing a third of the greenhouse gases, not 80%. If you remember those numbers, they look like about $40 to $50 per ton. That will increase the cost of electricity by 20%. Okay. Price signals are a polite, politically sophisticated way of saying we have to raise the cost of this because there are benefits in doing so. It will convince people that they cannot simply burn coal and gas and emit it into the atmosphere and say that solar and wind are too expensive because we're hiding some of the costs. They cannot continue to walk away from that squiggly, funny-looking bulb and say that it's too expensive because we are hiding some of the costs when we reach for that traditional balloon-shaped incandescent bulb. Price signals alone won't do it. Even with those price signals, to save money over the long term, there is a need for access to capital. We are an A-rated company. We are a widows and orphans stock. We are as safe can be. I used to borrow money at 6%. Today, my mirror image companies, sister companies, are borrowing money at 9 and 10%. Capital is precious. The utility industry is the third largest borrower, consumer of capital after government and the financial services market. we are having trouble accessing capital. I cannot imagine what it would be like if I walked into my small customers who had half a dozen attorneys and said to them, I've got a great idea for you. Give me $10,000 and I will change your heating system, and in the next 5 years you'll thank me. They would either think that I was legally insane or they would laugh at me. Can you imagine having the same conversation with the struggling pizza parlor owner about their oven? And so on and so on and so on. This will require a complete change in the way in which we regulate utilities. Utilities for 100 years have prided themselves on being universal access providers, whether it was in telecommunications or in electricity or in gas. We have for over a century been vehicles for capital deployment to achieve social objectives. This will take the same here. Utilities will have to have rate structures that investors have confidence in, that are predictable and forward-looking, so that we can access the capital markets to make these investments on behalf of customers, because customers will not do it on their own, or the customers who do it on their own are those who can afford to do it, and once again, we will be leaving people behind, the people who can least afford to be left behind. Lastly, if we have access to capital, if we have the price signals, we will need the workforce to do this, and Angie spoke about this as well. The good news here is that these are job-creating opportunities, and for once we'll stop talking about financial instruments and financial technology and convince ourselves that we're really investing somewhere, and we'll start investing in the real economy, and we'll do things that make for decisions and hardware and assets that make better use of our resources, leave the world slightly cleaner and greener for our children and grandchildren, and actually employ people in a way that creates real value. Having said that, I simply say that innovation will come in many shapes and forms in the future. It'll come in the shapes and forms of technology. It'll come in the shape and form of public policy changes. It'll come in the shapes and forms of regulatory reform. I hope you stay curious. I hope you stay involved. And I hope you stay with us. One of the things that I am very embarrassed to admit is that I am the epitome of the generation that swore never again in 1973 when I had to wait online if I had an odd license plate ending on an odd day of the week, an odd day in the calendar, and then went ahead and forgot. And fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. Fool me three, the expression doesn't even carry anymore. So if we don't do something about the $147 per barrel of oil, the $14 per MMBTU of gas, that was now ancient history of 3 months ago. And if we lull ourselves into thinking that $70 oil is here to stay and it's going back to $50, if we don't recognize the energy security implications of and the transfer of wealth that occurs as we continue to be dependent upon unstable parts of the planet, if we don't recognize the risk that we are putting our grandchildren in terms of climate change, then there will be some very dire consequences. I don't believe that to be the case, so I didn't know how to finish that last sentence. I think we will recognize the risk, and I think we will do something, and we will make it happen. I genuinely thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak with you today, and it's a pleasure being here.
About a second, yes. But please ask short questions so we can get as many questions in as possible, okay?
Notwithstanding the capital challenge you referenced, do you have plans on the drawing board where consumers who want to make the energy efficiency, maybe you smooth it the same way you have budget payments? You say, okay, you do this energy efficiency. If you're going to save $20 or $30 a month, we'll just continue charging you that until you meet the capital that was required.
We have a plan that is similar to that but not identical. The plan is simply to say, if the customer is saying at 100%, whether it's financed by the utility in your scenario, or financed by a bank, or financed their own savings, they're still walking away and saying, I don't want to do that. So instead what we're saying is, what is it that we need to pay the customer, literally pay the customer, to reduce the price of that investment and therefore increase the return, so they will do it. What that means is then we would issue grants, install the equipment, and the customer would pay the difference. In our proposal, it would be 20%. We're asking customers to put down 20%. And the rest of society would pay that 80%. Now, the business community has a very strong visceral reaction to that. So everybody's rates go up a little bit, but one person's bill goes down a lot, the person who got the equipment. And the answer to that is yes. There are three benefits, at least, to that subsidization. Number one, we all benefit from the cleaner environment. Number two, we all benefit from having to build the next power plant, which is going to be more expensive than the current power plant. Number three, if we do that intelligently, we are going to target those markets that make the most sense, who are probably being subsidized today anyway, be that indigent population in inner cities, or perhaps public facilities. So you just shift taxpayer burden to ratepayer burden. What have you done by doing that? Now you've increased the marginal cost of buying electricity to all customers. So the next customer that you want to convince to participate, it's an easier sales job. Why? Because their rate just went up. So the savings are even stronger. So maybe you don't have to ask them to pay 20%, maybe they could pay 21%. Eventually, the economic theory, which we've discussed at great length with many people, is you would do that for the whole customer base. At the end, there's always going to be somebody who says, I don't want to do that, it doesn't make any sense to me. But now their rates have doubled, and their bill has doubled because they haven't changed their equipment. And they will say, uncle, and they will give in, and they will make the switch as well. So at the end of the day, you have 2 million customers now with higher rates. Oh my God, thank God Izzo's never running for office. But you have 2 million customers with lower bills. What, does anyone here know what their electric rate is? I have no idea what my electric rate is. I know what I paid on my bill last month. So we have to educate the business community, which is the strongest negative visceral reaction to energy efficiency, unfortunately, that there's a big difference between energy rates and energy bills. And what we need to be concerned with is energy bills. Your proposal makes a lot of sense for some customers. If they don't have access to capital, we would have to ask why. Are they a creditworthy risk for us? The second challenge with your proposal is measuring the specific benefit from that particular investment. We don't have that degree of sophisticated metering in the home. So if we change someone's lighting right now, their bill will go down, but I won't know how much of that is due to them, to that lighting investment, or them maybe changing their behaviors on their air conditioning systems, et cetera. So it's a worthwhile approach, but we've thought long and hard about it, and we think our approach makes more sense, albeit we have to get over the subsidization issue that will unfortunately be thrown back at us. So you said short questions, and I give long answers, unfortunately. I'm sorry.
I want to preface my question by saying that I'm from a company that has plans to introduce about 50 megawatts of hydroelectric power in the region over the next several years. Is the loan program for that you described earlier, can it, or I understand it's not now, but could it be possibly available for hydropower projects?
The loan program is not now. It is strictly for solar projects. We are appealing to the Board of Public Utilities to allow us to expand our investments, not only in terms of dollars, but in terms of different technologies that we can invest in. The one, quite candidly, that I'm most interested in right now is combined heat and power. We just didn't think there was a lot of hydro available in New Jersey, but it's something I'd love to learn more about to see whether or not that makes sense.
I'll give you my card after.
Okay, thanks.
Yes. Nice.
What kind of increases can we see in electricity over the next 5 years per year?
The answer to that question is the same answer as so many questions. It depends. At the current cost of natural gas, which is what sets the price for electricity, I would expect that we would see about a 2-3% increase in electric rates next June. The reason for that, I won't bore you with the reason for that. I'll just give you the answer. Depending upon how aggressive we are in climate change mitigation, for every $10 per ton of CO2 for every $10 per ton in the cost of CO2, electric rates go up about 6% in this part of the country. So if you believe that they will go to $50 per ton, you do 5 times 6%. Right now in REGI, the regional greenhouse gas emission, carbon cleared at $3 per ton. So it's minuscule. It's like it's about a 1 or 1.5% increase in rates.
Okay, what about to pay for the rebate program though? With the societal benefits charge and all
Yeah, so you use the terminology that most folks in the audience wouldn't be familiar with. So how do people pay for this? In the case of carbon, it'll be passed through the wholesale power price. Now, what the state has done that I think is absolutely brilliant, this state, is they said, okay, we're going to take the money that wholesale power producers need to pay to purchase an emission credit. I'm sorry for getting really arcane and detailed here. And take that money, right, so that $3 per ton is revenue that comes to state government, and we're going to redistribute that in ways that achieve social objectives. What are some of those? We're going to give it to EDA to invest low interest rate loans in businesses that want to invest in energy efficiency. We're going to put some money into low-income energy assistance programs. We're going to fund renewables programs. So I give the state a ton of credit. I give Angie, her predecessor Gary Rose, Governor Corzine, a ton of credit. They're saying, look, this is not a windfall. We're not trying to raise rates and then fund, I don't know, pick some topic that maybe people don't want to fund. We're just saying this needs to be done, and if the market isn't providing that solution because Congress hasn't gotten off of their, because Congress hasn't gotten their act together and enacted legislation, then we're going to do it here and start sending that price to the best extent possible. So none of it at current flows through the SBC, as you refer to. Other question?
I have two questions. How can we monitor the energy uses in our own homes? Is there a meter that you could supply us that we could hook to our local area network and we could see demand real time?
The answer to that is there are devices. I mean, there are amp meters, there are volt meters that one could buy. It would not be the best use of your money. There is a ton of work that's been done, particularly in California, which, by the way, has very high electricity rates and very low electricity bills because their per capita consumption is low, but they've been working at this for 15 years. There are the scores of literature that you can gain access to that uses a terminology called deemed savings. It's basically laboratories who have done the work that said, okay, if I use this technology instead of this technology, here's how much I save. But I'm not familiar with anything that would tell you, give me your G brand model number of your refrigerator and here's how much you're using. If you give me a name and number, I'll have somebody in our DSM, demand side management group, get back to you and say if there's some low cost way to do that. One of the things we are trying to do to get at this issue is change the metering technology we have in place today. Right now, you have a very dumb meter on the side of your house. It's a meter that we read once a month. It's mechanically driven. And what we're trying to do is put in an advanced metering infrastructure that allows us to read meters instantaneously every 5 seconds, every month, however frequently we would need to read it, to be able to assess the effect of making investments in a home on energy consumption. So for example, we would do before and after studies. We would read your meter for 3 hours in August on a day where the THI is X to see what your consumption is from your air conditioning system. We then go through this program, we subsidize the changing of your air conditioning system, we take that same reading using a smart meter for the same abbreviated time period to measure the savings. That's as far as the technology has gotten to my knowledge.
Great. Second question, where can we go if we want to learn more?
Our website, for one. Yeah, pick up the literature on the outside. Yes, right here.
You touched upon one of the two themes, the decarbonization of electricity. How about the other one, which is far more immediate, the electrification of transportation, because that enables you to walk away from liquid fuel?
So in that regard, the two things that we would hope to be able to help with is number one, fleet purchases, and number two, making sure that there is metering capability at the public locations whereby people will need to recharge their batteries.
we're not going to get into the electric car manufacturing business, though. But I have had conversations with Rick Wagoner, the chairman of GM, about how we can help them with that. They are quite candidly betting the future of their company on this technology and don't want to rush to market prematurely, given some of the challenges they have with battery technology.
What's the time frame you see for PSE&G doing something?
Probably 2011.